All right. So let's quickly summarize the four controlled sources. The first thing that we saw was the incremental voltage controlled voltage source, and that's the common drain amplifier. Vi, Vo. Then we saw the voltage controlled current source, that's the transconductance amplifier. So this is R, this is Vi, and this is, what's the transconductance if GM is very large? 1 by, so it's Vi by, this current is Vi by R. The current controlled voltage source, or the incremental output voltage, In times R, and the current controlled current source, this is I out equals that. Is this clear, people? All right. So now, once you have these individual building blocks whose behavior you all understand, it's straightforward to come here to put many of these together, right, to do stuff. For example, this is the incremental diagram. Alright. Okay. So now, I mean, the circuit looks pretty complicated, right? But you should be able to stare at it and tell me, assuming that GM is large, what is the output voltage? V minus V in R 3 R 6 divided by R 1. Very good. Let's see if this makes sense. All right. So, what comment can you make about the incremental current there? Vi by R1. Okay. So, what is the next stage following? What kind of control source is that? Current controlled? What is the input impedance? GM is infinite. What is the input impedance? Come on, 0. So, where will all that current Vi by R1 flow? It will flow into, people, R3. Why not R2? Why not R2? Yeah, what is the incremental voltage at this node there? Come on, people. 0. Why? Gm is infinite, so that incremental voltage is 0. So what will be the volt current flowing through R2? 0. Correct? So all the current Vi by R1 must flow through R3. So what is the incremental voltage there? R3 by R1 times Vi. Okay. And what about R4? Does it affect the voltage there? It does not, because people, why does R4 not affect the voltage at that node? So it's a we said that Gm is infinite, so it's a current controlled voltage source. So loading it will not change the voltage. So R4 has no influence on the output. So what comment can you make therefore about this current? R3 Vi by R1 R5. Okay, so what is the, what comment can you make about this voltage here? Current flowing into, it's minus R3 R1 R5 Vi times R6. Okay, what about this voltage? What kind of control source is the last one? It's a common drain amplifier. So what comment can you make about the output? Same as the input. So basically that's the, okay. But if you are thorough with this, you will be able to stare at this and then simply say, right, what is it? R6 by R3 times, R6 by R5 times R3 by R1 with a negative sign. Correct. And now, I mean, if I now add the biasing to all this, I mean, it will look really, really complicated. But even then, you should simply be able to take a look at it and say, this is the gain. Correct. What is the input impedance? Infinite. What is the output impedance? The output impedance is 0. All this is assuming that the GM, you know, everywhere is considered large. Is that clear? All right. So, I mean, so the bottom line is this. So, when you, I mean, it's now putting, I mean, these are the four building blocks, then, you know, you can just like Lego, you can put various things together in various fashions and, you know, build all sorts of circuits, okay. And in the exam, if you, or, you know, in your professional practice, if you see some circuit, you know, the first thing is not to panic. Right, it's not very likely that you know you've seen these circuits before, right? In your exam as well as in your job, right? But there's nothing to panic, right? You basically, with careful analysis, you will be able to identify these building blocks, and then you know from there you should be able to figure out what's going on. Okay. Last resort, you know that in electrical engineering, everything must obey KCL and KVL, right? So, you basically run through the algebra, right? If you find that you have zero intuition about the circuit, then you run through the algebra, which will take you forever, right? But you know that there is nothing deeper than that. Hmm? All right. So the next thing that I'd like to talk about is, so far we assumed that the IV characteristic of the transistor, so the output characteristics of the transistor, right, we assumed to be the drain current ID in saturation, we assumed that the current is independent of VDS, provided VDS is greater than some VDS minimum, which is VGS minus VT. Unfortunately, I mean, it turns out that I lied. So, in reality, the slope of this line in saturation, which is, which we said was 0, is not quite 0. There is a small slope. Something like that. Okay, so the red curve is the true characteristic and the black one is the idealized one we have been seeing so far. Okay. So, the ideal characteristic we said was in saturation was ID was 1/2 mu n C aux W by L times VGS minus VT the whole square. Correct? Now, it is not quite that. So, you know, what do you think you can do? What do you think we can do? We have to fudge the characteristic, fudge the equation so that it matches the curve, right? And it does not take a genius to figure out that it is. I mean, it looks like a straight line, right? It is proportional to VDS. So, it is some 1 plus lambda times some constant times VDS that turns out to be that that parameter is called lambda, all right. What are the units of lambda? Per volt, okay. And this is often, this, I mean, those who have done device physics class before. This is called channel length modulation factor. Okay, I mean, if you don't know how that came about, don't worry about it. It's some minor detail as far as the from the physics of the transistor. But at any rate, you measure the transistor characteristic. This is what you see, and this equation models the characteristic pretty okay. All right. So, the equation for the transistor has evidently changed. So, therefore, what comment can we make? What are the consequences of the equations changing? The model will change, right. So, earlier, so Y11 was still 0, the gate current is still 0, and therefore, Y11 and Y12 are 0. Y22, which was earlier 0. What is Y22? Dou ID over dou VDS, which was earlier 0, is now going to be is 1/2 mu n C aux W by L times VGS minus VT whole square times lambda. Okay. Now, you know, as I said, I mean, this is going to be, if you have to try and remember, we like to write the GM as a function of, you know, the bias current, right. So, now if you have to put that in here, you can see that the equation is very messy, all right. Okay. Because to solve for this, right, now becomes a bit messy. So, as you know, when the going gets tough, engineers start to make approximations. So, that lambda VDS, we assume that is a, I mean, what comment can you make about that lambda VDS? You hope that it is, you have a good transistor, so that lambda VDS must be small compared to what? 1. So, if that lambda VDS is small compared to 1, this is what comment can you make about this guy? This is approximately ID. So, this is nothing but lambda times ID. All right. Dimensionally also, you can see it is consistent because capital ID is current, lambda is reciprocal volts, so that is conductance. Okay. And what about GM? Well, for GM, you know, you the GM, true GM as per this equation is nothing but mu n C aux W by L times VGS minus VT times 1 plus lambda VDS. But again, this being very close to 1, people simply continue, at least for hand calculations, you just basically say that this is mu n C aux W by L times VGS minus VT. Okay. In any case, to get the exact operating point and the GM and all that, I mean, those of you who have done a device course know that all these toy equations are only there for the textbook. A real MOSFET will have much more complicated behavior, which is, you know, almost impossible to figure out, I mean, unless you have a computer. So, anyway, you need, you need a computer. So, for hand calculations, what is the point, you know, breaking your head over a model which is complicated and inaccurate, correct? It makes sense to spend time, you know, with complexity if you know that you are going somewhere, right? If you know this is wrong, you know, anyway, what is the, and you would anyway go to a computer, you know, why break your head, right? So, that is the philosophy. And you basically say, well, I will continue with my old, you know, GM equation because not worth it. And likewise, the output resistance is just simply lambda times I, right? All this is good enough for hand calculations. For a detailed calculation, you anyway go to a computer. I mean, and all of you have no doubt heard of SPICE, yes? Right? Okay. All right. So, so you put a plop all this into a simulator and hit the run button and you get all the answers that you are looking for. So, our model now is only slightly modified. So, this is GM times V capital GS. This is often called RO, it is also sometimes called GDS. The conductance is called GDS, right, because it is between the drain and the source, right, and GM expression is known, RO is 1 over, it is basically 1 over lambda I.